We're back for another episode of your Lakers Nation podcast. I am Jabari Davis, and this week, Jamieson Welsh and Jordan Buscarini will join me for discussing Kobe's now official farewell tour, and I guess some of how, you know, some of the players are from both from around the league as well as on his team are reacting and coping with some with all of the extra hoopla and attention surrounding the team. We're going to actually definitely get into some of Magic Johnson's comments. You know, and Magic's been a guy, he's been vocal about the team, you know, over the last few years. Well, obviously, you know, he's a huge, you know, he's admitted he's a, you know, the biggest Lakers fan out there. You know, obviously, he's a former great, but, you know, he had some very interesting, you know, comments once again regarding Jim Buss in the front office. But I actually, you know, a bit later on in the show, I want to discuss the potential for some of these veteran pieces that the front office might be looking to, you know, to move before, prior to February's deadline or maybe even, you know, long before it. But, you know, actually, Jamieson, I'm going to come to you first because, you know, I feel like so much of the, you know, so much of the, our discussions and so much of the, you know, the of the narrative surrounding the team, you know, ends up being negative. And of course, hey, look, you know, we're under no disillusion. They're 3-17, you know, at this stage. You know, they're heading into, you know, a back-to-back. I think they're at Toronto, to, you know, by the time, you know, this show comes out. But talk to me about, you know, some of the signs that D'Angelo Russell has been showing, you know, the continued progression of Julius Randle, and obviously Jordan Clarkson, and quite frankly, who's probably the team's best player or most consistent player at this stage.
Well, it's interesting that you bring that up because the young guys are, it's like they're being more, they're more comfortable in being aggressive on the court. Even though with Kobe out there, you know, not being as efficient as we'd all like him to be, the young guys are picking and choosing their spots to be, you know, more aggressive and, you know, pretty much getting adjusted to NBA plays. We still got to remember, this is the first 2 months of the, you know, their NBA careers for the most part for Julius Randle and D'Angelo Russell. So, I mean, it's still a learning process, but we see flashes every game. We see something good every game. Of course, we're going to see bad things because their young players are still developing and they're still growing as players, but the flashes that we do see are they're promising flashes. They're things that you want to see them improve upon, and you, there's things that you can say, okay, well, I see something here, we have something here. My only concern with that is whenever you have a situation like what's going on with Kobe and the, you know, his last season going on, they're witnessing someone taking a lot of shots and a lot of bad shots at times. You don't want young players developing bad habits. And watching that on a night-in and night-out basis or a lot of nights is something that you don't want young players to fall into. That's not something that you don't want young players to kind of, you know, thinking, accepting that that's going to be okay. So we'll see how that goes forward. But in terms of their individual play, they've been pretty solid for the most part. I know a lot of people, you know, get caught with, you know, Porzingis and whatnot, but everything relative to expectations, honestly, you know, for right now, the Lakers, rookies, and young guys have done pretty well relative to expectations. I know D'Angelo Russell's not going to be rookie of the year. I understand that. But they've been pretty solid. I think you have to understand what's going on with the team and the offense they run, but they'll be okay.
Yeah, I think D'Angelo and Jordan, of course I'm coming to you, but I, you know, to your point, I think D'Angelo's actually been pretty solid. You know, heading into the year, all types of expectations were out there. Anytime you're the second pick in the draft and anytime you're coming to the Los Angeles Lakers, we all know that there's going to be an extra, you know, the extra attention is going to be paid to you. And you know, and you alluded to it, the, you know, the comparisons to Porzingis and, you know, Okafor and some of those other guys, that's inevitable. But, you know, for my money, you know, right now, I'm looking at his numbers, and Jordan, I'm coming to you with this. You know, D'Angelo's right at around 11 points a game. You know, he's got a shooting percentage up above 40%. You know, a 3-point percentage. You know, he's up. You know, right around 32%, and seems to be, you know, improving at that. He rebounds extremely well for his, you know, for his size and his position. He's, I think he's at, you know, he's averaging about 4.8 per game. Assists, of course, we'd like to see more. I do think that some of, you know, some of his low assist totals. You know, he's averaging 3.1 on the year. I think some of that could be due to the, you know, quite frankly, to the lack of talent around him at, you know, at certain stages in the game, but in particular, I think because of the system that they continue to run. What are your thoughts on Russell in particular, and what would you like to see out of him?
Well, I think you hit it right on the head when you bring up the rebounding for Russell. That's something that I've really been impressed with over the last couple of outings. I think if you look at his last 10, 11 games, he's actually averaging close to 7 rebounds per game, if I'm not mistaken. So he's proving that he can be serviceable in several different aspects. Now, Jamieson brought it up, he's not going to be Rookie of the Year. I don't think, at least I didn't have expectations for him to be Rookie of the Year going into this season, especially when you had a couple of bigs like Okafor and Towns going to squads. Well, first off, you have Okafor going to a team that's just absolutely horrible. He's going to be the center focus. You know that his numbers may even be a little inflated because of it. Then you take a look at Towns. That's a team that's ready. I mean, they're a year, maybe 2 years away at the most from actually being a very good team in the Western Conference. I mean, they competed at a high level. And then you have D'Angelo falling in between. It's still a team searching for their identity. They have other growing pieces within that team. And, again, I believe that a lot of Russell's growth, you have to contribute that. You have to contribute his growth to the growth of somebody like Julius Randle, to the growth of Jordan Clarkson, who has been the most consistent player on this team. So as they grow, Russell's going to grow. That may not make his numbers look good. A lot has to go into the eye test. So when you're watching the Lakers, pay attention to the way that Russell's moving off ball. Pay attention to the way that he's moving baseline. Pay attention to the way that he's moving around 15 feet. Pay attention to the little things he's doing that won't necessarily stand out if you're following the basketball. Now, with that being said, the last 10, 12, maybe even 15 games, he's been a lot better than he was the first 5, 6, 7 games of the season. So I see a lot of growth in D'Angelo Russell. I may have been one of his biggest critics at the beginning of the season. Expectations that I had for him 4 or 5 games into the season were extremely low. Look, he's exceeded those expectations because he is getting better. Now, of course, as I've said time and time again, wins and losses are arbitrary numbers. You can't expect a whole lot from this team. You have to look at growth. And Russell is actually, he's growing at a fairly decent rate, something that gives me promise for the future. And I'm also starting to see some sort of chemistry between him and Jordan Clarkson, and that is huge moving forward.
All right, you bring up Clarkson, and I'm going to open this up to each of you to, you know, discuss back and forth. You know, I don't want to say I defended him. I was repping pretty hard on Clarkson heading into the year. I'm not saying whether I was right or wrong, but the reason why I'm bringing this up in particular is, I went back and forth with certain individuals on, you know, whether it's just a matter of a decent player putting up, you know, good numbers on a bad team, or if Clarkson is actually the real deal. Now that we've seen, you know, 20 or so games into his second year in the league, he's leading the team in scoring, if I'm not mistaken, or maybe Kobe still is, but he's averaging 15.8 points. He's getting you 3.5 rebounds a game, still, you know, dishing out, two and a half assists, up over a steal per game. But the real improvement that I've been really, you know, impressed with is the fact that, you know, he's raised his shooting percentage. He's right at around 48% from the field, but from the 3-point line in particular, he's just under 44%. Talk to me about the improvements that he's made in his game, and actually, what is his, you know, what do you guys think his or feel his actual ceiling may be?
It's an interesting situation because Jordan Clarkson's a guy, whenever you have second-round guys, it's always different. You know what I mean? It's always a situation to where, you know, you just never know, what's going to happen. They could have one good year, and, you know, next year you just never know. But at the same time, he's gotten better. He's gotten better. Every time you see him, he's getting better. He's icing into his game. His mid-range game is better. His defense is even improving. He attacks the basket. His three-point ball is getting better. Every time you watch him play, he's that good. So with me, when I look at him, he's a guy, he reminds me a little bit of prime Monta Ellis, when Monta was getting like 25 a night or 20, 25 a night on the Warriors, when he was coming, you know, just scoring at will. He reminds me of that guy a little bit, bigger than Monta was, but at the same time, he's doing pretty well. My thing is this with him, what position does he play? Because it seems like he would be him and D'Angelo are both, you know, they're both really lead type of guards. Clarkson's more of a two guy, but he needs to have the ball in his hands to be at his best. So it's kind of an interesting situation. But from what I've seen now and his improvement from last year to this year, even in summer league, has been really promising. And he's going to be fine. Like, I don't have any worries about him. He has that hunger to get better. Every time, even since the first summer league, before he played as a rookie in the NBA, you saw that he was different than most guys.
Look, when you evaluate Jordan Clarkson, and this is serious when I say this, I'm serious. The Laker front office has to evaluate this guy with where he's sitting right now because, again, and I know we're going to talk about contracts a little bit later on the show. You mentioned one individual who's fallen out of the rotation who has a very desirable contract right now based on skill, dollar for dollar. You take a look at the CBA. You look at Jordan Clarkson. This is a guy that's making $854,000 this year. He's an unrestricted free agent at the end of the season. No reason to believe the Lakers won't retain this guy if they choose to. You need to look at Jordan Clarkson, and you have to evaluate what you believe is going to be his ceiling, because it is interesting. What position does he play? Is he a tweener? Is he that guy that sticks in between the point and the shooting guard? Because I think Monta Ellis at times, and I like that comparison a lot, Jamieson, it goes deeper beyond their play on the court. Remember, Monta was also the second-round draft pick as well. When you look at Jordan Clarkson, and you look at the comparisons to Monta, I think Monte's had identity crisis a couple of times in his career. Where did he play? Where did he fit in? If you don't believe that Jordan Clarkson is a franchise player, you have to understand you used a second-round pick on him. If you can move Jordan Clarkson at some point in time this year, if he doesn't reach your to where you believe he can, if he doesn't match up to a franchise player in your mind, you may have to look at moving him, because the value is going to be there for somebody making $854,000 and is an unrestricted free agent who's playing at the level he's playing at. I'm not saying move him, but I'm saying you have to ask two questions. Is it worth it to move him? Can you better this team moving forward? Can you get the assets to improve your squad looking ahead? Or do you make him a franchise player? I don't think there's any in-between with Jordan Clarkson, because I think you've hit a home run with him already. So those are the two questions the front office needs to – that they have to answer at some point in time between now and February. And I'm sure a lot of people listening are saying you're crazy. You're going to trade Jordan Clarkson? You have to evaluate it. If you don't believe that this guy is going to be a franchise player moving forward, the way he's playing right now, if you don't see this, if you see a ceiling coming up soon, you may need to look at moving him. And I know that that's been a topic that's been discussed over the last couple of weeks.
It absolutely has been, and that's, and I'm so happy you gave me my perfect segue. Here's the deal. You just hit it on the head. He's going to be an unrestricted free agent. So, Jamieson, put your GM hat on. We used to play this a lot on Triple J. Let's bring it to Lakers. Let's bring it to the podcast. Put your GM hat on for me. You've got Jordan Clarkson coming up at the end of the season. He's going to be a free agent. Obviously, he's going to be a free agent, and he's probably going to be sought after by several teams. And I shouldn't even say probably. He's definitely going to be sought after by several teams, especially if he continues to to play even at this level. Let alone continue to improve. You're the Lakers. You've got a guy like Harrison Barnes out there, who's also been mentioned as a potential target, in this offseason. Obviously, Kevin Durant. Some of those other names. Do you spend that money on bringing him in on one of those mini max deals, or do you look to as Jordan mentioned, and of course we're all speaking hypothetically, do you potentially look to move him prior to the deadline?
Well, no, I don't look to move him at the deadline, because you usually don't get, fair value whenever you, make a deal to deadline. Very rarely do you get the better end of a deal if you're making a deal to deadline. It rarely works out that way. My biggest thing with Jordan Clarkson is this. You got to pay him. You got to take care of him. One, you have a boatload of cap room, island loads of just cap. Also, the cap is going up. So, that contract, whatever you're paying him, won't really be a huge dent in the overall grand scheme of things. So I think you got to bring him back if you feel he's going to be the guy going forward, or one of the pieces of the puzzle going forward. And that's something that management has to make a decision on. I think he will be one of the pieces going forward, but Jordan brings up a good point. He has a very friendly contract right now, and if you decide, this guy might not be the guy, or he may not fit in, then you could definitely look to moving him. But if you move him, you got to bring something back that, is just as good, if not better. You can't move him just to move him. So, personally, I think that the Lakers should sign him to the mini-max deal this offseason and let him grow with the other young guys. I think they can build something special. Whether they do or not remains to be seen. I think they have the potential to build something special here.
I agree. I agree with Jamieson. There is the potential for something to be special there, yet at the same time, it's very, very rare that the best player on your team has a non-guaranteed player option contract for a third season, and he's making $854,000 a year. I believe that's the number. I keep throwing that out. I believe that's what he's making this season. It's very rare. In fact, we've never seen it under this new collective bargaining agreement. So you're holding cards close to you that nobody else in the league has had under the new CBA. It's uncharted territory, and they can't mess this one up. To me, Jordan Clarkson is the piece that you can't mess up. If you want to pay him with the cap raising, I have no problem with it, but you have to commit to this guy as being a franchise player. Otherwise, you move him while he's extremely movable, because there isn't a team in the league that wouldn't eat up that contract right now.
Oh, no, without a doubt. And to be clear, again, we're all just speaking hypothetically. Neither one of us want the Lakers to move on from Jordan Clarkson. I personally think he's going to be one of those pieces of the future that they can definitely build around, that they already clearly, in my opinion, are. But to Jordan's point, the consideration has to at least be there from a business perspective. And here's a hypothetical I'm going to throw out there to you guys. Say Sacramento 20 games from now, they're still playing well below what their expectations may have been, even though I had these expectations for them heading in. But say Sacramento comes to you and says, okay, look, we weren't willing to do it before, but what if you throw us two of your three young guys? would you guys consider it? And if so, which ones would you, which ones do you think would be the best fit in terms of I guess in terms of retaining in order to partner with a Boogie Cousins?
Well, that's a really tough question because there's so many ifs in that scenario. But obviously, if you have a chance to get a guy that talented, you got to do it at that point. You have to bring in at some point in time. You have to bring in elite talent, one way or another. Whether you acquire it via trade, free agency, or have draft or whatever, you have to be elite talent that's able to produce right away. Eventually, you have to make that turn. If you have a chance to do that, I think you have to. Obviously, Randall would be one of the guys that would go. If that were to be the case, Randall would be one of the guys that would go. And it would probably be, it would probably be Clarkson. Like, they'd probably get rid of Clarkson if that's what took place. Because I wouldn't see them trading away the number two pick that's a natural, point guard guy that's a natural, distributor of the basketball away. I don't see that happening. But, it's all hypotheticals. And also, you just never know. Things do come down the pipe. Like you mentioned, Sacramento's not having the best season at all by any means. They just had a game tonight where they – gave up a huge lead and lost to Oklahoma City. So there's so many things going on, you just never know. But at the same time, I do think that a deal with Randall and Clarkson could potentially get DeMarcus Cousins if it came down to it.
Jordan, I'm going to jump in before you answer that and actually throw this little wrinkle in. What about, and again, I'm playing devil's advocate. Everybody understands that I'm actually a big Boogie Cousins fan. So when I say this, I'm just playing, giving the opposite side of the discussion. What about what about the notion of if DeMarcus Cousins, yes, clearly he puts up numbers and clearly he's he's been individually successful in this league, but would you really consider dropping two of your assets for a guy that hasn't been able to figure out how to win on his own at this level? What about that what about that side of the argument?
Well, look, we've had this discussion at the beginning of the season, and when the discussion of a potential move for DeMarcus Cousins popped up, I said I would trade the entire roster for DeMarcus Cousins.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people looked at me and said, are you serious? Yes, because I think DeMarcus Cousins is a solid building point. We're talking about a 25-year-old kid who's an all-star center already in this league. With that being said, from what I have seen from Julius Randle and what is his rookie season in the NBA, regardless, it's his rookie season. Look, he played one game last year. It's his rookie season. I have seen Julius Randle do things with a rookie-scale contract. I don't necessarily know that I would give him up for DeMarcus Cousins anymore. At the beginning of the season, I was all for it. I didn't know what type of shape Julius Randle would come in. I didn't know how he would respond from that injury. Yet there have been signs from Julius Randle that make me think, I don't know if I would include him in a deal for DeMarcus Cousins. Now, if there was a way you could get DeMarcus Cousins and not give up Julius Randle, I'd be all for it. I don't think that's possible. From what I see, to me, with the contract that he has, and again, we can talk skill all you want. Even with the salary cap rising, you have to look at a player dollar for dollar for what they are making. I believe Julius Randle is going to be special in this league. We know he's going to be a double-double guy. We know that.
Mm-hmm.
If we're talking bare minimum, he's a double-double guy. I don't know that I would include him for DeMarcus Cousins based off of the baggage that DeMarcus Cousins has brought in the past. I don't know that I'm willing to give up a guy like Julius Randle for a guy that still has several question marks, even though he is an all-star. And I'm not questioning the talent of DeMarcus Cousins because we know he's an all-star center. I'm talking about DeMarcus Cousins off of the court. Would a change of scenery be good for DeMarcus Cousins? I say yes. It would be fantastic for him. Yet I'm still not willing to take that risk based on what I had seen from Julius Randle this season. I don't know that I would include him. At the beginning of the season, we've talked about this, guys, off of the cuff. I was all for it. I don't think I would anymore.
That's fair. That's fair. Based on what you've seen thus far from him, I can understand that. I mean, again, all of this, this entire conversation is hypothetical, as Jamieson kind of alluded to, you just never know. And, when it comes to this front office, with some of what they've tried to do, haven't necessarily been successful at, this is going to be a front office that I definitely could see. I don't want to necessarily say swing for the fences, but these are individuals that have to make something happen over these next couple of years because quite frankly, even though every organization is going to go through down years, you simply don't want to string together 4 and 5 and 6 and and beyond that, that many down years, like in a row. As you're trying to get back to the promised land. But let's actually discuss some comments from Magic Johnson. I brought him up earlier in the show. And this is a guy that's been vocal, you know, very vocal in the past. He continues to. The comments, you know, were actually courtesy of the LA Times. Forgive me, I can't remember, you know, the writer. I think it was Eric Pincus, but I'm not 100%. It was either Eric Pincus or Baxter Holmes, but you could find it there. But basically, Magic said, you know, and he's speaking of Bus, he should just be the owner, like his dad was just the owner. Let's go back to the facts. You know, so I can back this up with facts. This is Magic Johnson speaking, of course. 27 wins a couple years ago, 21 wins last year, three summers now where we haven't signed anybody. I'm backing this up with facts. You know, we haven't signed any superstar. We've had cap space. We had cap space last summer, yada, yada, yada. And basically he goes on to say, you've got to get somebody to help out. Just play your role. And of course, he's speaking to Jim Buss in this situation. Just play your role. There's nothing wrong with being a great owner. Now, here's my stance on this, and I'm coming to both of you guys for this. Magic absolutely deserves the right to question and criticize the organization wherever he sees fit. But we have to be straightforward about things. While the points that he's addressing may be valid at this stage, there is a bit of revisionist history taking place. Because if I'm not mistaken, and you guys can correct me on this if I'm wrong, Johnson publicly endorsed, not only did he publicly endorse the Mike D'Antoni hire, but I know for a fact that he openly celebrated both the trades for Steve Nash and Dwight Howard. Now, clearly those things didn't work out and probably could have been handled differently, but I don't think that you can necessarily go back and crush somebody for doing some of the things that you actually agreed with publicly when it took place. Jamieson, talk to me. Am I wrong in saying that Magic kind of straddles the fence in this? Is he 100% right? What are your thoughts on that?
Magic wants to feel loved, and sometimes the only time he feels loved and important is when he's making comments like this to where it makes SportsCenter and ESPN and all the blogs. It's an unfortunate situation because Magic knows people's phone numbers. Like, he knows they contact someone, have a meeting, whatever. Certain information really doesn't – like, he's not making the situation better. Like, whenever he comes out and makes comments like this, it doesn't make whatever situation is going on, it doesn't make it any better. So it's unfortunate that he feels this way. It's definitely unfortunate that he has to feel – he has to make these comments to feel like he – you know, he wants to get some attention. It is very unfortunate. We know the situation isn't what it's like, isn't ideal. But also, think about this. He knows what the NBA landscape is, or at least he definitely should know. It's not as easy as going out and signing a free agent. Like, those days are long gone, just going out there and getting the best guy available. Free agency is not the same. And also, being an owner, it sounds good. But you know what? I would like for Max to be a little bit of a bigger person and handle things a little bit more mature. He's a guy that, you know, he's a guy that's a business guy and a guy that has done a lot and, you know, professes pretty well in terms of ownership. I like for him to handle things a little bit differently, especially when he's the owner himself. He's part of the ownership group himself of a team in the same city that's underachieved the last 3 to 4 years. So I would like to see him take a little bit of an approach, because if Jim said that in the media, then it would be, you know, all the gloves would come off. So, I mean, Magic kind of has to really calm down and really needs to relax and focus on other things at this moment, because he's not helping the situation. I want Magic to be able to help the situation, not hurt it. And also, I would like to see him be in some of these free agent meetings, be on some of the presentations and whatnot. I think he needs to be more helpful than hurtful at this point.
Jordan, to his point, that's an excellent point that you just made, Jamieson, so that's why I'm coming to Jordan with it. Is this a matter of a glass house, you know, type situation, or does Magic have a point? Where do you sit on this?
Let's be real here, okay, for a second. Working in media, when I go to NBA locker rooms and I talk to other media members, every now and then there's a certain topic that people will necessarily jump on and agree with for the sake of agreeing. And it seems like right now Jim Buss is a punching bag. It seems like it's the cool thing to do at this point in time. Okay, so let's look at this realistically. If the Lakers acquire Chris Paul, we may look at Jim Buss in a completely different manner than we look at today. Okay, if that trade is not vetoed, we are looking at Jim Buss in a completely different light. Then you talk about the Dwight Howard trade. Anyone who puts down the Dwight Howard trade needs to examine it a bit closer. Yes, there's future draft picks that were included in that trade that may or may not go to L.A. based on protection, and we can get into that. That's a whole other topic. The fact is, the centerpiece of that deal was Andrew Bynum, who has not played a meaningful minute in the NBA since the trade. Okay? He played rent-a-center for one season with Dwight Howard for Andrew Bynum. While playing rent-a-center, you had an all-star power forward, you had a pretty good perimeter defender, and you went out and you traded for Steve Nash, who may have been on his last leg. At the same time, you had a gaping hole at the point guard position, and you went all in for a title, hoping that going all in for a title would keep an all-star center like Dwight Howard, who you traded, again, a guy who was on his last leg, and Andrew Bynum. That whole situation could have worked out differently. Hindsight, looking back, yes, they probably should have went with Phil Jackson. I do believe if they go with Phil Jackson, Dwight Howard is probably still in Los Angeles. I do believe that things maybe go a little bit different that season, but it's hindsight. Jim Buss went all in for an NBA championship immediately. I didn't disagree with any move. I didn't have a problem with any move at that time. Now, it didn't work, and now we're looking back on it saying, boy, what has Jim Buss done? Yet at the same time, Jim Buss has been faced with difficulties that his father that he never had to deal with, okay? The collective bargaining agreement is stacked so up against large market teams that it's not a coincidence that Brooklyn, who had a payroll through the roof, is one of the bottom feeders in the NBA. It is not a coincidence that New York, another team that had an astronomical payroll, is struggling to become relevant once again. And it's not a coincidence that the Lakers are in that same situation. Why? Because they had the highest payrolls. The collective bargaining agreement is now $4 compared to $1 for repeat offenders. That's something that Dr. Jerry Buss never had to deal with. I'm not saying that Jim Buss is not to blame here. I'm just saying you've got to look at things from a realistic point of view. And Magic has the highest payroll that we have ever seen for Major League Baseball, and they can't get out of the first round of the playoffs. Okay? Magic Johnson, the Dodgers, had the number one and number two punch, or the best number one, number two punch in the majors. We're talking about two guys that finished second and third in the Cy Young race and could not get past. And now, you know, you look at the New York Mets went to the World Series, but couldn't get past the Mets. Last year, couldn't get past the Cardinals. Magic Johnson has went out and tried to buy the best team money can buy in Major League Baseball since joining the group with the Los Angeles Dodgers, and it hasn't worked. Magic has every right to voice his opinions about the Los Angeles Laker organization, yet at some time, first off, he's the worst tweeter in the world. Second, I wonder if Magic, I do believe his heart's in the right place. He has the Lakers on a pedestal. He believes that this commitment to excellence, I'm using a football term for you there, Jabari.
Yes, I appreciate that.
It runs true in the Laker organization. During Magic's 12 years, and we'll call it a 12-year career with the Lakers, you got to remember, they went to the finals 9 times. Magic has expectations for this Los Angeles Laker team that at this point in time, it's just not realistic. And let's just say for an instance, that Jim Buss hits it out of the park in the offseason and the Lakers sign LaMarcus Aldridge. That was the big free agent fish this offseason. Hey, you hit it out of the park and you sign LaMarcus Aldridge. Is this team really a championship contender? Now, I'll tell you where this team is at. This team is now probably a 10 seed in the Western Conference, which means you're not going to the postseason because LaMarcus Aldridge, for as great as he is, he's not going to make this team a championship contender, okay? So now you're faced with losing out on your draft pick next year to Philadelphia because it's top three protected. And you have a max contract to a 30 going on 31-year-old man by the time this next offseason rolls around. So it seems like it's become the cool thing to do to pick on Jim Buss. But look, a lot of things went into it. I mean, you can point the finger at David Stern. You can point the finger at Father Time catching up with Steve Nash. You can point the finger at Mike D'Antoni running Kobe Bryant into the ground where he tore his Achilles, because I still believe if Kobe avoided that injury, he still has 2, maybe 3 years left in him. You can point the finger at so many different people in this organization that we all love Jeannie. Everybody, Jeannie has been in the spotlight for the majority of the time as the lovable daughter, that now Jim is the guy that you look at as the punching bag. And I don't know that it's necessarily right. And rant. I know that was long. Hopefully the listeners are still sticking with us. But look, I'm just looking at things as a realistic point of view.
No, I think that's fair. I do. And look, here's the thing. Whether the listeners agree, whether I agree, whether Jamieson agrees, I think we can certainly appreciate where you're coming from with that. I'll give Jamieson an opportunity to not necessarily rebut, to respond, and I'll set you up like this, Jamieson. You mentioned Magic being helpful instead of hurtful. You mentioned him potentially sitting in on some of these meetings, which I actually think would be an excellent idea. Last week's episode, I think we even talked about Kobe Bryant being a part of these meetings in while some of the listeners out there may hear that and say like, oh my God, no way, because they've heard some of the negative feedback, or I guess some of the messages that have been put out there in the media which have actually been denounced by the actual players. But I actually agree with that stance. What is going to be the ultimate answer? Because even though I agree with where Jordan's coming from, there's a lot that went into it. There are an awful lot of people that deserve some of the blame and can certainly raise their hands. Ultimately, even with all of that, we're still left with a 3-17 team that is in the state that it's in. What is your ultimate answer for this front office?
Man, honestly, you have all these legends for a reason. You have all these guys that have done great things for the team and the community and whatnot. When you need them the most, they need to be there for you, and namely Magic Johnson and Kobe Bryant. Those guys have been the face of your franchise for the last 40 years, it seems like. So if that's the case, if those are going to be your guys that you have statues of and you retire their jerseys, well, they also need to help you when you need to recruit free agents to find that next face of the franchise or create that next dynasty. And that's what you want to do. You want to keep everything in-house. You look at the Tunis Miami Heat. Miami Heat, they've been around for 25 years. But they have a very family-oriented thing going on there. And Pat Riley, one thing he does, he keeps everybody around there that is part of their family. And, you don't hear a bad word from an ex-player about their front office. It just doesn't happen. So I wish things would be a little bit more different. But obviously, I think the biggest thing in this situation is this. Magic isn't on the inside like he used to be before Dr. Buss passed away. And when you're not on the inside, you don't have that same information, that same connecting. You're not in the know like you used to be. Then you feel different about the people who are in charge. And he's voicing his frustration more often than he should. But hey, that's what it is right now.
That's fair. All right, let's go ahead and transition back to Kobe. Because I've loved, some of the adulation the current and, former players have been showering him with. Even with the Durant stuff, because I completely disagreed, and I don't think it's necessary to defend him, but I just appreciate how much reverence, this current crop of stars has for Bryant. One guy, on the flip side of that seems to be a bit tired of what looked like the final steps of the process seems to be Nick Young. Now, I'm not going to put words in his mouth. I'm not going to, say, it's very clear. But, from my opinion, and you guys, again, can always, disagree with me, from my opinion, he seems to be tired of playing second fiddle or third fiddle or whatever the case may be, to Kobe Bryant. I guess he mentioned – his frustration mounting, after being ejected against Detroit. But this is something, in my opinion, that's been going on for a long time. Jamieson, you in particular, we discussed Young falling out of the rotation the other day. And even though I had a different take on the reason behind it, I saw your point when it came to being difficult to maintain an offensive rhythm, which we all know is something extremely important for a guy like Nick Young, when your minutes are consistent. I'm going to open this up to both of you guys and ask, is it at all possible that some of these weird lineups and questionable rotations are actually with the idea of packaging some of these guys like Brandon Bass and Lou Williams for additional assets, or even for a more favorable or complementary player with some of what they're trying to establish for the young guys? Or is it just a matter of Nick Young, just falling out of the rotation because he said something that they don't like?
Well, there's a lot of things going on. One is, yes, you have a lot of veterans, and we have a lot of veterans on the team, and the team's not doing that well. You look to get rid of them to get something back for the future, whether it's a young player on another team that fell out of favor or just some pieces. You look for something else, to help your team going forward, or with draft pick, young players, whatever. But also, Nick Young's upset because, one, he wants to go 7-for-26 in a game or 15. He wants to get those shots. If he's not getting those shots, he feels that, hey, he's left out the party. But at the same time, it's tough when you're watching someone shoot that many shots and they're not going in, and some of them are really bad shots. It's tough to watch that, especially if you're on the court. If you feel that you have a better shot or someone else has a better shot, it is tough to watch that. So I get his frustration. I really do. And unfortunately, his frustration boiled over in the game versus Detroit. But at the same time, Nick Young's a guy that I understand where he's coming from, and he has all the right to make that comment, but, man, when you're the one making that comment, you got to expect some heat coming back. It's unfortunate that he got a couple of DMPs after that. But I understand where he's coming from. And I'm not going to ever have sympathy for an athlete or whatever, but I get where he's coming from. I really do, because really, when you're watching it, when you're on the court, you're watching it. We all know basketball. We all know what's a good shot, what's a bad shot, what's a good player and a bad play. When you see repeated bad shots and there's no flow to the game and you got young guys who are trying to mature and get ready and get better, it's tough watching 3 out of 4 games each week of that going on. So I understand where he's coming from, but you have to understand when you make those kind of comments, there's going to be consequences.
Yeah, I agree with Jamieson. I do understand to a point where Nick Young is coming from. But look, in 2012, one calendar year, Nick Young played for the Washington Wizards, the Los Angeles Clippers, and the Philadelphia 76ers. And I'm going to tell you right now, Nick Young didn't play for 3 teams in one calendar year because he had great shot selection. Okay, so let's be honest here for a minute. Nick Young has taken questionable shots his entire career. But, no, I do understand where you're coming from. Bottom line is, with Nick Young, he doesn't fit the Kobe Bryant mentality. He's not cut from the same cloth mentally as Kobe Bryant. And he's definitely not cut from the same cloth as Byron Scott's old-school mentality. Nick Young is a different kind of player. Nick Young will get moved at some point in time this year because Nick Young, we're talking about contracts, and I said we'd get to this a little bit later on. Nick Young has a very desirable contract, okay, based on the guys. You look at somebody like Avery Bradley, and I'm not taking a shot at Avery Bradley, and I'm not taking a shot at Jody Meeks, but you take a look at the contract that those two guys signed, and then you compare it dollar for dollar where Nick Young is sitting. That's a very desirable contract for another team that's missing a scorer off of the bench. Nick Young, at some point in time this season, will get moved. That contract is too – the Lakers have done – they did too great of a job setting up that contract to not reap some sort of benefit from it. And let's be honest, when you've won 3 out of 20 games, the best possible way to make something out of that contract is to move it and get something, some sort of future asset for it. So to me, Nick Young has one of the more movable contracts, one of the more desirable contracts in the NBA, and I would not expect him to be on this Laker roster come March. Trade deadline, if not beforehand, Nick Young's going to be on his way out, and I think that'd be best suited for everybody involved, especially if you plan on bringing Byron Scott back next season. These two have never been on the same page. They haven't been on the same page since Byron Scott took the job last season. So at some point in time, it's going to be a relationship that needs to end. At some point, it's going to happen. I'm not knocking Nick Young. I understand where he's coming from. When you have Kobe shooting 4 of 20 and they are questionable shots and you got a guy taking 12, 13 three-point shots a game and hitting 2 of them, yeah, it's probably going to be a little bit frustrating because at this point, you probably, to me, or I think to anybody, a more reliable shot from downtown is Nick Young than Kobe Bryant. So at some point, it's something that needs, it's going to be a divorce that needs to happen.
You're probably right, and you're exactly right about the fit with Byron. That's like oil and water. That's just that was never going to work. In fact, when Byron was hired, my first thought, and Jamieson, I think I shared it with you, was okay. Well, then that means Nick Young and Jordan Hill. Obviously, I'm speaking of that first year. That means they're out of here. Obviously Jordan, parted ways, and he's doing his thing, and with the Pacers. But I fully agree with you on the Nick Young situation. I understand, both of your guys' side and his perspective in terms of the frustration. But, all in all, regardless of whether Byron is, Byron is going to be back, I could see that marriage, ending in a divorce sometime, very soon. But, of course, we'll discuss that over the course of the season. It'll be an ongoing thing. Obviously, the team, they appear to be transitioning more and more to, trying to feature those young guys, and as they continue to do that and continue to potentially move some of those pieces, that that's really what the focus is going to be over the second half of the year anyhow. All right, guys, great show this week, and I appreciate you guys for joining. Instead of a final shot, since the last episode, obviously, Kobe Bryant announced that he was officially going to retire, and most of the shows and everybody had an opportunity to go ahead and offer the not necessarily their condolences, but their favorite Kobe this or what they would remember about his career. So instead of final shots this week, let me get your favorite Kobe Bryant moment. Again, we're gonna it'll be a part of the discussion over the course of the season, and I'm sure we'll do this again another couple times. But let me get one for tonight.
There's two. I'm sorry, I can't break it down to one. First one, I have one in the number 8 jersey, one in the 24 jersey. Is 2004, last game of the season, Sacramento Kings losing Golden State. Lakers go to Portland where they've been terrible. They've had, they've had issues in Portland forever since we've been born. And pretty much wins, ties the game up, goes overtime, hits a deep three in overtime or double overtime to win the game, win the division, instead of being a 4 seed, you go into the 2 seed, change the whole landscape of the playoffs, and they go off to the finals. But that's my favorite, Kobe moment in the jersey. Number 8, jersey 24 is a little bit different. Phoenix game 6 of the 2010 Western Conference Finals, where he pretty much didn't let him lose. Like, you know, that was the last, like, moment where he was just, like, ungodly on the court. Like, there was nothing he could do in that fourth quarter. Like, he was just unstoppable. I mean, that was something that you knew he was going to shoot it. There was nothing you could do about it. And that was that. And they were off to a finals, and then were off to a ring. And it was times were really good. But, yeah, that was my favorite Kobe moment in the 24, just seeing him just go off and just not – you just couldn't do anything about it. That's the demoralizing factor of his scoring and the way his playmaking was really, really crazy. It's been a joy to watch.
Nice. Jordan, what about yours?
You know, growing up, Kobe Bryant, I mean, after Magic, you were always looking for that next Lakers star. Who is it going to be? You know, for a very long time, we pretended to be Nick Van Exel out on the basketball court. Kobe Bryant was the guy that took it to the next level. He was the next Los Angeles Lakers superstar that kids wanted to be out on the playground. So when we talk about my favorite player growing up, it's kind of like my kid, for instance. Okay, I have one child. So my favorite player is kind of like my child. Of course, like my favorite kid. I have one. Now, as far as my favorite Kobe moment goes, well, that's like my nieces and nephews. There's too many to pick. I love them all. You know, I love them all. There's several moments that stand out to me. Let me throw this one out. Game 7 of the NBA Finals against the Boston Celtics. You look at the box score. What will stand out to you in that game is Kobe was 6 of 24 from the field. He was 0 for 6 from downtown. What I remember is Kobe elevating his game and pulling down 15 rebounds in that contest. An exhausted Kobe with 30 seconds left. You watch Kobe walk up to the foul line, and Kobe, I mean, he's got his hands on his knees. Kobe's exhausted. He's beyond exhausted. Shot isn't there. He finds another aspect of the game to take over. In fact, 15 rebounds. That was second to only Pau Gasol in that game, who had 18. Those 15 rebounds helped catapult the Lakers to an NBA championship. That's one of the moments that I'm always going to remember. And look, inspiration-wise, Kobe stepping up to the foul line against the Golden State Warriors, torn Achilles, pops 2 foul shots. That's a moment that you look and you see in his face, he knows that his season, maybe his career is over, yet he still limps up to the foul line, he pops 2 foul shots. I'm going to remember that. I'm always going to remember the alley-oop to Shaq in Game 7 of the 2000 Conference Finals against the Portland Trailblazers. You don't win that game, we have no three-peat. We have no number 8, number 34 three-peat. That's a moment I'm always going to remember. And still, one of the moments that I always get chills, and even though they didn't win the series, one of the moments that I will always get chills on is Kobe in the final 30 seconds. It was Game 4 of the first round of against Phoenix back in what would have been 2006, 2007, I believe 2006. Kobe knocks down the game winner off of the jump ball. Luke Walton wins the tip. Up against Steve Nash, Kobe gets it at midcourt, takes it all the way down. He pops a 15-footer off of the right side of the court, double-teamed. Lakers go up 3-1. Didn't win the series, but he took over. He took over to get that game to that point as well, him and Splash Parker. So there's several moments throughout Kobe's career that stand out to me. Those are the few, though, that I remember very, very vividly.
You know, my goodness, more than anything, this trip down memory lane, you know, these last couple of minutes have really just given me that exact feeling that you're talking about. I can still feel the goosebumps or the goose pimples or whatever you call them, that I felt at that time. And, you know, so I'll just leave it with this. I'll leave it short and sweet. The 2000 Finals against the Pacers, Game 4, Shaq fouls out. Kobe just went to work. I think he put up 28 in the game. So it wasn't one of those, just crazy, 60-point, 62 or 81. It wasn't one of those, but it was just the way that he did it. It was kind of like his elevation from Kid Kobe, bear with me, from Kid Kobe into not necessarily the Mamba, but into the guy where it was like, where if there were any question whatsoever, he ended all doubt that night. I was fortunate enough to be at Game 2 of that Finals. That was actually the game where Jalen Rose stuck his leg. And, it's funny that he had not acknowledged that or admitted that he did it on purpose. I was at that game where he stuck his leg underneath him, and it looked like, oh, no, wait a second, Kobe might be out for this entire series. But that comeback in Game 4, they were able to win on the road. And obviously, they're taking advantage in that series, and obviously come back home and close it out. You know, that's definitely always going to be one of my favorite moments. Again, we'll discuss these over the course of the, you know, over the rest of the season, I'm sure a couple more times, you know, like, as these guys, you know, like you just kind of, you know, broke down. And as I just mentioned, the, you know, the moments are endless in terms of, you know, obviously over, you know, what has been a great 20-year career. But we just wanted to take a quick moment in order to, you know, show some love and, you know, and take a stroll down memory lane for you guys as we wrapped up this week's show. Next week and moving forward, we'll try to catch up with some of the guys, you know, some of the, you know, talented individuals from the site. I'm hoping to catch up with Serena Winters. Definitely, you know, definitely looking to, you know, to get back with Troy and Corey. You know, we didn't get to the, you know, the roundtable discussion this week, but we, you know, that'll be back next week. But you know, as always, we appreciate you guys, you know, that take the time to tune in each week. We appreciate your feedback, you know, whether it's via Twitter or, you know, any other route. And, you know, we hope that you can stick with us again for, you know, Lakers Nation podcast next week. Thanks for listening.